say come. And let him who hears say come. Whoever is thirsty, let him come. And whoever wishes, let him take the free gift of the water of life. He who testifies to these things says, yes, I am coming and coming soon.
Good evening, everybody. My name's Tessa Shannon, and I am from the Kaurna tribe. It sounds like smoke alarms. Okay. I have been asked, maybe we might get that taken care of. Okay. I have been asked to do the welcome to this country this evening. Should I wait?
It's just wanted to let you know the smoke alarm is going off and they're going to turn it off in about half a minute.
Thank God for that. I'll start again.
I don't think this is working.
Is that working? The microphone? No, it's not working.
What about this?
Good evening. Nothing's working.
Hello,
can you see me?
Yeah,
okay. Good evening. My name is Tessa Shannon and I'm from the Kaurna tribe. I've been asked to do welcome to my country this evening, but before that, I would like to acknowledge our creator, God Mama. Lord, we acknowledge your glory and lean on you for help, for your help and protection. We acknowledge you in all our ways, in the things that we do in our lives, and ask you to direct our path by removing obstacles and leading us forward according to your will. We seek you first, Lord, for you are our creator and our provider, for without you, we can do nothing. Today, we meet on Kaurna country. I would like to acknowledge the Kaurna people who are the traditional custodians of this land. I would like to pay respect to the elders, both past and present, and extend that respect to other Aboriginal people here today. It is a privilege to be here on Kaurna country, worshipping with you all. Welcome and God bless. Thank you.
Well, I trust that your tents pegs have been pegged down and the caravans are lined up and that you're all ready. Yep. Do I need to turn something on? Okay. Well, we've got no audio at the moment, but I think you can hear me, can't you? Yeah. We tried very hard to make sure that the beginning to this camp was very memorable for you. And I think we have succeeded. And so whilst we wait for the audio to get restored, I just wanted to take the opportunity to formally welcome you to Big Camp 2016 here at Tanunda. And as I indicated, this is quite a memorable start to our camp. But thank you all for coming along. I was trying to say that I hope that your accommodation is all settled and you're looking forward to a very fresh night tonight for those of us who are camping and staying here on the grounds tonight. We have almost 300 that have booked in here on site. And that would not include those that are probably staying in town or those of you that have come along for the evening. And I don't know if our live streaming is working. It is. I'd like to give a special welcome to those that are watching online. We have folk from across the state. And of course, there'd be a number of ex-South Australians who've tuned in. And who knows how many else have tuned in thanks to the the internet around the globe. Our speaker tonight is our own conference president, Pastor Andrew Kingston. This is his final camp, as Pastor Kingston is finishing up towards the end of this year. In fact, his I'm not sure if you're aware, his final camp was actually meant to have been a couple of years ago when he had, but a couple of things happened. He had a caravan that he had arranged to be here for camp, but unbeknownst to Pastor Kingston, a fire came through and burnt the caravan down. And then a replacement caravan came, and it didn't come in time for camp. It was just a week later, so he stayed on for another year. And so he's had to be here this year so he could finally use his caravan here at camp. Now, all jokes aside, we do look forward to Pastor Kingston sharing and opening our camp for us as he opens God's word for us tonight. Our theme, going home. In a couple of ways, it can be taken in a couple of ways. Of course, we would like to pray that we recognize that it's coming back to God where we ultimately are going to be at home, feel at home. Going back to Him, that's where we truly belong. And I pray that during this this week that our camp will be something that will lead us back to that. But there, of course, is the other aspect to going home. It reminds us of the very fact that we aren't actually home yet, our true and our ultimate heavenly home.
Yeah. sing of God's grace, yes? Isn't His grace good? Yes, amen? That's why we set up our tents in the freezing cold, right? Carlos, that's why you got out the Weber and barbecued your dinner this evening. Because His grace is good. We'll see Him soon. Would you sing this with us? Why don't you take a seat and sing this one? Thank you.
our heads. Let's bow our heads as we pray together. Our dear Father in heaven, Lord, we do want to thank you as we've come here and begun to praise you because you deserve it. We thank you that we have the privilege of knowing you. Thank you that you are the eternal, the everlasting, the really dependable one. When everything else may fail, even when we lose power, Lord, we know that you are always there. You are greater and more dependable than anything that we depend on here on this earth. And we thank you for that. Lord, we thank you that you are a God who gives us hope and a meaning and a future. We count it a privilege, Lord, to be able to praise you for that. We think, Lord, of our environment. We think, Lord, of our communities. We think of our neighbours. We think of our friends. And again, we count it a privilege that we are honoured to be able to know you as our God. In a time when there is so much uncertainty, Lord, where the people lose their jobs, whether they lose loved ones, or whether they lose just hope in life, you're one who is dependable. And it is to you that we turn, and we thank you that we can do that. We count it a privilege, Lord, also to know that you are the one who has not only provided for our past, given us Jesus who came and died on the cross to pay for all our sins, but is also one who wants to live in our hearts and one that we can look forward to meeting one day face to face. We sing soon and very soon. And beyond the veneer of our lives, we know that our hearts do ache for that. And so, Lord, we pray that that will indeed be the situation. I pray that you'll bless everybody that's gathered here this evening, those that may be watching online. We pray that as we begin our camp this week, that you will be present in a very special way through your Spirit to bless. We thank you for our children. The programs this coming week, we pray that you'll bless each of them. Our young people, we thank you for the seminars that are being prepared, the workshops that are being offered, and of course the opportunities to come together corporately to worship and praise you and to hear from your word. We seek your blessing tonight, particularly as Pastor Kingston opens your word to us. I ask that you'll speak through him to us. Most of all, Lord, I pray that we will listen with an openness and a new attitude. We pray that you'll bless our presenters throughout this week, our guests that have arrived and others that will come, and that your Holy Spirit will speak through them. May this not be just another gathering, another encampment, but may this be indeed a significant turning point in our lives as we seek to be more committed disciples of you who go on to impact those around us. Because we know we are going home and we want others to come home with us, is our humble prayer tonight in Jesus' name. Amen.
Deep.
cling to the cross? What else have we got? A Jayco? An Austrail? I'm telling you something, 2 years ago a gas canister took care of a tent just like that in my life. We cling in my family to the cross. There is nothing else that will stand the test of time, that will sustain us. The Bible says that we should give Jesus all the glory because he is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or imagine. According to the power at work within us, to him be the glory in the South Australian church. In Christ Jesus throughout all generations. Let's sing that God is able. God is able.
Our God is able.
lift up your name, you are able. Ephesians 3 tells us to do immeasurably more than we ask or imagine. Just give Pastor Andrew to you now as he ministers to us, as he shares the burden on his heart that you've placed for us. Bless him. Bless him as he speaks from your word tonight. We pray in Jesus' name.
Good evening, everybody, and let me give you a welcome to Camp 2016. It's really, really good to see you. Do you know one of the things I really enjoy about camp is when I drove in this morning at about, I think, about 8:30, only a couple of tents and one or two caravans here, and I do remember seeing Angie Thompson and Greg, her husband, trying to put up their tent, and it was a great blustery wind this morning. But they managed it, and I thought, wow, you know, isn't that commitment to see people come into camp and doing things like that? And then during the day to see all of you come and put up your tents or bring your caravans, your camper vans, or maybe some of you are travelling from home each night, and bless you for that. Maybe some of you are staying at the caravan park down the road and staying in a unit. Well, God bless you for that. But we're here as a conference church family. Amen. And I just would like us to reflect for a little bit on our journey. The theme for our camp is going home. And there is something about going home, isn't there? And I want you all to think about your journey and where you were this time last year in your journey. About 12 months since. How has your journey gone? Your journey in life. Maybe your journey with your family. If you're married, your journey with your spouse. Your journey with your children. And most of all, your journey with Jesus. How is that going? And it's good, you know, because Scripture tells us to examine ourselves to see whether we are in the faith. And it's good to do that, just to reflect on our journey as we journey toward home. I want to take us back to a story in the New Testament where the disciples are on a journey. They are in a boat again, in the middle of the lake again, experiencing a choppy sea and windy conditions again. But this time it was different, because Jesus was not there. His place in the boat was empty, and it felt very strange. They had gone and run ahead of him with what they thought was a marvelous idea, and now it's all backfired and gone wrong. We know the background of this story, and let's look at it, and then we'll see what happens next. We've read this probably ourselves many times. And he directed the people to sit down on the grass. This is the feeding of the 5,000. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish and looking up to heaven, he gave thanks and broke the loaves. Then he gave them to the disciples, and the disciples gave them to the people. They all ate, Scripture says, and were satisfied. And the disciples picked up 12 basketfuls of broken pieces that were left over. And the number of those who ate was about 5,000 men, besides women and children. So probably maybe 8, 9, maybe even 10,000 people were fed from that small boy's lunch. What an incredible miracle.
And the people noticed it. And what happened next, I think, gives us a background in which to build our thoughts this evening. It doesn't say it in Matthew so much, but when you go over to John, it says this. After the people, these are the people that were fed, after the people saw the miraculous sign that Jesus did, they began to say, surely this is the prophet, note, who is to come into the world. And they started talking with one another saying, this is it, let's move, let's do something. And Jesus knew exactly what was going to happen because John records this. Jesus, knowing that they intended to come and make him king by force. So this is the answer. We can raise an army. We can march on Jerusalem. Anyone's wounded, they can be healed. If they're hungry, they can be fed. No problems. Let's do it. So all the men conspired together. They came and talked to the disciples, and they thought it was a great idea. So they wanted to make Jesus the king. And John records this when you read it. Knowing that they intended to come and make him king by force, he withdrew again to a mountain by himself. Now, John doesn't fill in the gaps, and neither does Matthew, but when you put the two passages together, you can work out what happened. Because when you go back to Matthew, there's two words that stick out in my mind. The first word is immediately. See that? Immediately Jesus made the disciples get into the boat. See, the disciples were all for making Jesus a king. They were all for hurrying things along, for making him the Messiah and crowning him. They had it all planned with the men who were fed just a little bit before. But Jesus would have nothing of it. Immediately, Scripture says, Jesus made them get into the boat and go on ahead of him to the other side while he, Jesus, dismissed the crowd. Not now, he said, not ever. This is not my way. After he had dismissed them, he went up on the mountainside by himself to pray. So here you have the disciples alone in their boat. Frustrated, maybe a little annoyed at Jesus because they didn't see the true picture. And here is Jesus, as Scripture says, up on the hills around Galilee, and he's praying. You know, it's so easy to run ahead of God, isn't it? Say, I've got this real good idea, God, this is what I'm going to do, and away we go. Do you know what? We're still suffering from what Abraham did, aren't we? Please do not run ahead of God. I say that to myself. Because when you do, when you and I have our own ideas, it can backfire and backfire dreadfully. And that's what happened here. The disciples are in the boat. The Sea of Galilee is about 14 kilometres wide. They're a good way across, maybe 6-7 kilometres across. And they're thinking and talking and wondering why Jesus did not seize this opportunity. And then the story keeps going. During the fourth watch of the night, Scripture says, now that is a deadly time. That's between 3 and 6 in the morning. These guys had been by themselves for hours. Their imaginations had been going over and over again. They'd been thinking this whole thing through and they were getting more and more unhappy. And also more and more worried that Jesus wasn't with them. During the fourth watch of the night, the story says, Jesus went out to them walking on the lake. Please get the gospel in those few verses. The gospel always starts with God. Amen. In the beginning, God. When Adam and Eve sinned, God comes looking for them. And here he is here. Jesus went out to them walking on the lake. They were frustrated. They were probably annoyed. They didn't want to do what Jesus wanted them to do. And still Jesus comes to them walking on the lake. Amen, church? And that's what Jesus does to us. He's always looking for us, seeking us. The hound of heaven. Always. He will come seeking and saving those who are lost. When the disciples saw him walking on the water, they were terrified. "It's a ghost," they said. See, they'd been so busy, immersed in their own thoughts, in their own ideas, that they had forgotten what Jesus looked like. Are you with me? Boy, that's easy for us to do too, isn't it? We can sometimes get so self-absorbed and so focused on what we're doing that we forget about God and even what his plan is and what he's all about. They thought he was a ghost. But Jesus picks it up and he says immediately to them, "Take courage," he says, "it is I, don't be afraid." Now this is where the story gets interesting. Because enter Peter. We've got to give a drum roll here. Peter always manages to get himself into the act, doesn't he? You love this guy. "Lord," he says, "if it's you, tell me to come to you on the water." "Come," he said. Then Peter got out of the boat. Now, we need to probably imagine this scene. Here are the disciples. They see this figure walking across the water. And they're not quite sure who it is. But then they do realize it's Jesus. And Peter, who has always got something to say, he says, "Lord, if it's you, let me get out of the boat and walk on the water toward you." And Jesus said, "Come." Here's my lesson here. Big point. To really come to Jesus, to really surrender your life to him, to really live a life of faith, my friends, guess what we've got to do? We've got to get out of the boat. That's really hard because being in a boat is comfortable, especially when the sea is rough. It's a secure place. You feel safe. But I want to tell you that if we really want to experience Jesus and his power and his goodness, we've got to get out of the boat. And that's hard sometimes. And I want to challenge you in your journey as you and I are going home. Are you in the boat or are you out of the boat? And it seems to me if you and I really let go and let God, we're going to get out of that boat. And the interesting thing is, it takes total faith, total commitment, total allegiance. But the interesting thing is that Jesus was very, very willing for Peter to get out of the boat. He didn't say, "You're a stupid idiot. Of course you can't. You're not God. You can't do that." He said, "Come on, come, come." So Peter, Jesus was very willing for Peter to step out in faith and follow him and do something that was seemingly impossible. Boy, isn't that great? Jesus wants us, my friends, to get out of the boat. And I want you, as you're sitting here this evening, reflecting on your own journey with Jesus, where are you? It's so easy for us to live a complacent Christian, even Adventist life. We have Weet-Bix for breakfast. We have Nuttolene on our salad. We have all these nice things that Adventists do. But sometimes we're in the boat. It's comfortable in the boat. It's safe in the boat. And Jesus says, "Come on, get out. Get out of the boat." And so Peter gets out of the boat and he walked on the water. Now he might say, "Well, Peter, you know, I mean, this is typical Peter." But I tell you what, Peter had something to tell his kids when he got home that the other disciples didn't have, right? Peter had something to tell his grandkids down the track that no one else could tell. He said, "You know what? I actually walked on water as I focused my eyes on Jesus. I did it." I don't know how long it was for. Was it for 30 seconds, 1 minute? I have no idea. But my friends, don't miss the story. Peter walked on water. That's a huge thing. And God wants us and our lives to learn to walk on the water, to walk by faith, completely by faith. So far in our story, Peter wants to walk on the water. Jesus invites him to. Peter has to leave the boat to do so, and he actually walks on the water. Now, here's my concern. whether we like it or not, my friends, one of these days, you and I are going to need to walk on water. We're in the boat at the moment. Everything's secure. Just about all of us have a car sitting out there somewhere. We have a tent or a caravan or a camper van or a motel room or something. We've got some money in the bank, right? We have a measure of security. And it makes us feel good. It makes me feel good. But what would happen if those things were just taken away? Gone. Because I want to suggest that whether we like it or not, one of these days we are going to have to walk on water. Daniel says it. Talks about a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation. These are scary texts. But as Christians, we need to realize that they're a part of Scripture. We need to understand them. Jesus himself said there'll be great distress, unequaled from the beginning of the world until now. And when you read Great Controversy, she says this, Satan will plunge the inhabitants of the world into one great final trouble. As the angels of God cease to hold in check the fierce winds of human passion, all the elements of human strife will be let loose. The whole world will be involved in ruin more terrible than that which came upon Jerusalem of old. That's a frightening passage, isn't it? And if you and I are believers of Scripture, that's what it says in Scripture, and that's what Ellen White says there. One more. It is often the case that trouble is greater in anticipation than in reality. But this is not true of the crisis before us. The most vivid presentation, she says, the most vivid presentation cannot reach the magnitude of the ordeal. So what I'm saying, friends, is this, whether we like it or not, one of these days, one of these years, you and I will have to be walking on water. Will we sink or will we walk? It depends on our journey. It depends on our hold on Jesus, on our hold on faith, on our hold on truth. Because God will have a people who have the truth and the truth only that will see them through. Are we there? And I tell you what, walking on the water, I believe, is very possible. There is so much for us. You know, the Bible says we are more than conquerors in Christ Jesus. Number one, we have the good news of the gospel that says we are sons and daughters of the Most High God, that we have eternal life and have it now. We have the Holy Spirit who comes and indwells us and empowers us and guides us and blesses us and comforts us. We are never alone. Jesus said, I will not leave you as orphans. He said, I will come to you. Number three, we have prayer. We can always open our heart to God and tell him everything. Keep your wants, your joys, your fears before God. You cannot weary him. We have our Bibles, which point us to truth. And we have angels, whose Scripture says are ministering spirits who are sent to serve. That's an amazing thought, isn't it? That each of us, we have these alien beings, if you like, who have been sent by God to care for us, to guide us, to bless us, and to protect us. Well, let's come back to Peter. Peter's walking on the water. As I said, I don't know how long he did it for. But then the story goes on. But when he saw the wind, I'm not quite sure how you see the wind. Maybe you see the effects of the wind. Yeah? He was afraid and beginning to sink, he cried out, Lord, save me. Now to his credit, he cried out to Jesus when he was beginning to sink. You see that? Not after he'd taken a few mouthfuls on and he was starting to drown. The moment he realized he was in trouble, he cried out for help. And then here's another immediately. Immediately it says, Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. That's the God we serve, my friends. When you get yourself into trouble, when you start shipping a bit of water, when you're starting to drown, cry out to Jesus and immediately he will help you. Amen? Look at that, just made the lights go brighter. Isn't that wonderful? And then he says, O you of little faith, why did you doubt? See, this is all about trusting and having faith in Jesus. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he'll direct your paths. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and do not lean what? To your own understanding. Easy to say, my friends, but as you know, it's hard to do. Trust. Have faith. And believe. I love this quote from Steps to Christ, where it says, we shall often have to bow down and weep at the feet of Jesus because of our shortcomings and mistakes. True? But we are not to be discouraged. I'm glad that that's there. We are not to be discouraged. Even if we are overcome by the enemy, even if Satan gets you and traps you and you're a goner, even if you're overcome by the enemy, you are not cast off, you are not forsaken, you are not rejected of God. Claim that promise, my friends. Every day when you say your prayers, claim the forgiveness and the power and the goodness of God, that he loves you with a strong love that will always be there. So, what's this story saying to us? When we fix our eyes on Jesus, we can do the impossible. And I know there are many of you here seated here that have done incredible things for God and are doing incredible things for God. You're walking on water, and God bless you for that. You're doing things that you've never ever thought you'd ever possibly do. But God has enabled you and strengthened you. You've done it. Number two, to really experience the power of God and see his leading, we have to get out of the boat. That's a challenge. To live a life of faith in every way. It's interesting, you know, I've been working for the Lord probably nearly all my life. And I've been to places and done things that I never dreamt I would ever do. Because when you give your life to God, you just don't know what's going to happen next. You have no idea. I've visited people who have sat there with a gun under a cushion and said to me, you make one wrong step, buddy, and I'll blow your brains out. Well, what do you do about that? I've had the privilege of preaching to thousands, 5,000, 6,000, 7,000, 8,000 people at once. What an honor that is to be able to stand for God and present the good news of the gospel. Being in lots of countries of the world, this is the what does when you give yourself to God. Absolutely no idea how God blesses us. And he does. Number three, Jesus is very willing to have us live this kind of life. That's a challenge for all of us. Number four, it is scary. It is scary being out of the boat. But as long as we keep our eyes on Jesus, we will be okay. Amen? It's scary giving yourself to God. It's always nice to be able to feel the bottom of the water rather than having it 300 feet below you. Step out in faith. Live a life of faith and God will bless you. And the moment we take our eyes from Jesus, which is easy to do, and see the problems around us, we're in trouble, no question. But Jesus is always with us, especially when we're out of the boat. I love this passage. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more. You've probably got that underlined in your Bibles. I want to encourage you as I encourage myself to claim it. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Amen, church. Amen. That's a promise for us to claim. Immeasurably more. I want you to look at the talents and the gifts that God has given you. And he's given all of you some. He's given me some. Are you using them to the glory of God? Are you using them to grow the church? Are you using them to grow the kingdom? Dream big, think big, plan big. Young people, don't let the world tell you you're useless and you're nothing, because you're not. You're a creature made in God's own image, and God wants to use you in a marvelous way. And I tell you what, it was so good for me to see young people, young people up the front playing their musical instruments to the glory of God. Amen? That is good. Keep doing it. Because I tell you what, we older people are going to move off the scene of action soon. As Joseph said, this is my last time to speak to you at a camp meeting as your president. It's time for me to move down the back of the bus. It was one pastor said, when you can no longer swim the deepest sea or climb the highest mountain, it's time to move on and let the young people have a go. And when you look in history, when God wanted something done, do you know what he did? He used young people. Every time. And maybe old people, we need to step back and affirm our young people and say, come on guys, go for it. You're the ones who can do it. We will support you. We will guide you. We will help you. But you are the ones. That's the way, my friends, this work is going to be finished. I tell you. If you look at our church, when it was first formed, and you looked at all the people who were involved in leadership positions, I think the average age of them was about 22 years of age, something like that. So come on, church. Let's give our young people a go. Let's encourage them, pray for them, support them. And we need to pass on the torch to them, so they will have the same burning hearts that we have, the same zeal that we have, the same fire in their bellies that we have, so they can go and do greater things than we ever did. You know, I thought I was going to go home when I was quite young. I never thought I'd get married. Never thought I'd have children. You probably thought the same thing, right? But here I am. 70's looming a little closer every year, not there quite yet. And still the Lord hasn't come. But I'm going home. We're all going home. We're on this journey of faith. And I know by the grace of God, and I claim it humbly, that I have eternal life in Jesus. But I want Jesus to use me powerfully, and I want him to use all of us powerfully, so that Jesus can come soon. What would happen in our church if we had just 100 of us throughout the conference, 100 of us scattered around this state of South Australia, say, right, I'm going to really stand up for Jesus this year. I'm going to make a difference for Jesus this year. I want to live for him this year. I'm going to get out of the boat for him this year. I'm going to walk on water in the power of God this year. What would happen? As you witness to your neighbours, your family, your friends, your work associates, intentionally and prayerfully, filled with the power of the Holy Spirit, I wonder what would happen. Because, my friends, I still believe there are people out there wistfully looking to heaven. Amen? They are. Living hopeless, meaningless lives. And you and I have been called as disciples and followers of Jesus to go and make a difference. So let's go and do it. Let's go and do it. And if only 100 of us did it, I tell you what. What did Jesus do with 12 disciples? Actually, it was 11, wasn't it, in the end? What did he do with those 120 in the upper room in Acts chapter 2? Turned the world upside down. And he can do the same thing today. The gospel, the work of the gospel, is going to end as it began, with power. Huge movement right around this world. Oh, well, that's interesting, isn't it? When did that happen? Doesn't matter. I want to close with a story as I take you back to China. China during the time of Mao Zedong, in the mid-60s to the mid-70s. There was an old man whose name I'll call Mr. Wong. Apparently that's not his real name. True story. Mr. Wong's heart was filled with passion for Jesus Christ. Oh, there it is. And he used to go around telling his friends and neighbors to say, good morning, he said, do you know my friend Jesus? Now, this was not to be done in China because in China at this time, Chinese people don't share their inmost feelings, number one. And number two, it was against the laws of the country. Everyone was supposed to read the sayings of Mao Zedong in his little red book. But Mr. Wong didn't worry about anything like that. He'd say, excuse me, do you know my friend Jesus? And he found that there are a lot of people that wanted to know about his friend Jesus. And so he did it for week after week until one day there was a knock on the door. He knew it was going to come. He opens the door and there were the blue-clad youths with the red armbands, the notorious Red Guard. They said, sir, we hear you've been talking about someone you shouldn't be talking about. You've been talking about this man, Jesus. And he said, yes, I have. He said, do you know my friend Jesus? I said, no, be quiet. You're not to talk about him anymore. Do not do it. He said, I can't help it. He's my friend and he'll give hope in your heart. No, they said, do not talk about his name. He said, I cannot. They said, we have ways of making you stop talking about Jesus. He said, perhaps, but I will always talk about Jesus. They said, okay, is that your final word? And he said, yes, it is. He said, right, we're taking you to jail. He said, I'm ready. And he had his little bag packed. And he picked up his bag and they put the dunce cap on his head and off they marched him to jail for talking about his friend Jesus. Well, when he got to jail, one of the first things he did was say to the fellow prisoners, good morning, do you know my friend Jesus? And of course they didn't. And so he started telling people in the jail about Jesus and about the hope that was in his heart and the journey that he was on, that he was going home one day. And then the prison authorities called him in. They said, what are you doing talking about Jesus? He said, I can't help it. You must stop it, they said. He said, I can't. I need to share my faith about my friend Jesus. They said, okay, we'll see about that. We'll send you to another jail, a stricter jail. He said, I'm ready. So he took up his little bag and off they took him to jail number two. Now, this jail was a lot stricter than jail number one, but it didn't deter Mr. Wong. Excuse me, he'd say, do you know my friend Jesus? And of course, there are many prisoners in this jail that also wanted to know about Jesus. And so Mr. Wong shared with them until he was dragged one day before the governor. And he said, I've hearing that you're talking about your friend Jesus. He said, yes, I am. I've got to do it. You must stop. It is against the law. You must not do it. He said, I've got to do it. I said, right. This is your second prison, isn't it? Yes, he said. Okay. He said, we'll fix you this time. We're going to send you to a really, really tough jail. We are going to send you, they said, to Qinghai. Qinghai was up on the high plains of China, where it's bitterly cold in summer and absolutely freezing in winter. There's grass growing around the place that if you eat it, you die because it's poisonous. So off to Qinghai, Mr. Wong went, feeling a little bit fearful. He goes to Qinghai. And one of the first things he does was, and you've guessed it, hello, he said, let me tell you about my friend Jesus. And this went on for several days until they called him in and they said, we know what you're doing. This is Qinghai. You do not disobey us in this jail. Do you understand? He said, I understand, but he said, I've got to share my faith about Jesus. Do you know my friend Jesus? Shut up, they said. Do not talk about him. He said, I will always share Jesus. He said, you will not talk about Jesus. We will do something really bad to you. He said, I don't really mind what you do to me. I must talk about Jesus. So they said, right. So they got him and they took him in a room and they tied his hands behind his back with a rope and they put the rope over a beam And then they put another rope around his neck with a big stone tied around it, a millstone, and then they pulled the rope, and soon Mr. Wong was just hanging off the ground, only by about a foot. And then they started getting shovelfuls of gravel and throwing it on him. And they said, "Give up your nonsense about Jesus. Give it up now." And he said, "I can't. I must talk about my friend Jesus." And his every bone in his body was aching. "Maybe tomorrow, but not today." They left him and came the second day. Asked him the same question as he hung there. "Give up your faith in Jesus." He said, "I can't do it. No, I must talk about my friend Jesus." And they threw more sharp gravel at him. His body was bruised and bleeding, caked in blood. This went on for a week. Until after a week, they said, "Mr. Wong, stop talking about Jesus." And there was no answer because Mr. Wong was unconscious. And so they cut him down and threw him on the dead pile outside the jail. Sometime later, Mr. Wong came to, crawled off the dead pile, and walked back into the jail. "Excuse me," he said. "Do you know my friend Jesus? He's protecting me." Well, the authorities did nothing for a little while, but then they'd had enough. And they took him into the same room, and they broke his arms, and they broke his legs. Here, 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 there, there. Hit him with a great big lump of wood. And he was unconscious, and again they threw him on the dead pile. About an hour later, Mr. Wong climbed off the dead pile and walked back inside. They couldn't believe it. He actually walked back inside. They said, "What is with this guy? It's crazy." And of course he said, "Do you know my friend Jesus?" He just couldn't stop talking about Jesus. Well, they allowed it to go on for a little while. And then they said, "Right, this is it. This is enough." It was the middle of winter. So they got Mr. Wong. They took him outside the jail, about half a kilometre away. They stripped his clothes off him and they tied him to a post. His feet and his hands. And they said, "There, Mr. Wong, goodbye. We'll see you later. Next time we see you, you'll be as dead as a maggot." And they left him laughing. And Mr. Wong thought to himself, "Hey," he says, "this is it, I've had it." And he was freezing cold and he could feel his body going numb. And he said, "Lord, I've been your faithful servant. Please just bless me now somehow. Do something so I can be a witness to you and your name." And as he prayed that prayer, he felt a presence beside him. And then he felt something tugging at the rope that tied his arms behind the pole. Tug, 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 tug. And soon his hands were free. And he was able to bend down and tie the knots that were tying his feet to the pole. And soon he was free. Which presented another dilemma. What do I do now? He says, "Do I go back to the camp?" "No, they'll think some of my friends have come and freed me. So I better stay here." So all that night, Mr. Wong prayed and did exercises and star jumps and tried to keep himself warm. And then early the next morning, he said, "They're going to come out and see if I'm dead, surely." So he said, "Oh, I better get myself organized." So he went back to the pole and he managed to tie up his feet to the pole again. So he put his hands behind the pole and he said, "Lord," he said, "please send your angels to tie the knot. So, you know, they'll think nothing's happened." So soon as the sun was coming over the horizon, the guards came out laughing. And they said, "Oh, Mr. Wong, you'll be dead for sure." And of course they got him. He said, good morning, a beautiful morning, isn't it?" They couldn't believe it. What is with this guy? So they untied the knots around his feet. But they took about half an hour, so he said, to untie the knot around his wrists. The angel knew how to tie some big knots. So Mr. Wong goes back into the jail. And of course, one of the first things he said, you know what? Do you know my friend Jesus? Do you know what happened to me? And everyone wanted to know how come he was still alive. And he told the story of redemption, the story of Jesus' love, and many in the Qinghai jail became believers. Wasn't long after that Mao Zedong died, and the notorious Gang of Four took over. And then they went, and I think a guy called Jiang Ouping, I have to look at my notes, but the next guy came along, and he was a moderate. And one of the first things he did was to release all the prisoners from Qinghai. Mr. Wong was one of the first to leave. Hundreds and hundreds of people had died in that place, but not Mr. Wong. He went home, a man in his 60s, and one of the first things he said was, and you guessed it, hey, he said, you know my friend Jesus. And when that story was written, Mr. Wong was in his 80s. And still every day he was going to his friends and neighbours saying, let me tell you about my friend Jesus. Amen, church? I want to encourage us to have the same faith as that, to have the same belief as that, to walk on water for Jesus and just witness boldly and fearlessly in his name. My friends, we are all on a journey. We're going home, and that is the best news ever. I just pray that as we enjoy the meetings of this camp 2016, that we will all sense the presence of the Holy Spirit, the presence of God, blessing us and filling us with his love, is my prayer.
Andrew, let's respond to God together, shall we? Would you stand with us?
Hope is built on nothing less.
Let's remain standing for prayer. Our Father in heaven, we just want to thank you, Lord, this evening for your great enduring love for us. That you care for us and that you bless us, Lord. That all the riches of heaven have been poured out to us in Jesus, in the Holy Spirit. And we have nothing to fear for the future, except as we see how you have led us in the past. Father God, give us a sense of your love and your goodness again, please, as we're on our journey home. May we see again what Jesus is doing for us and has done for us. Father in heaven, may we sense your love and your warmth and your leading in our lives. Father, challenge us to leave the boat behind and to walk on water, to walk completely by faith, trusting in you, being bold for you, living for you, being a Mr. Wong for you, if you like. Just telling other people of the hope that is within us. And Father, just take us this week. We commit this week to you. We commit this place to you. And Father, we pray that your Spirit will come and dwell here because we are here. Your angels will dwell here because we are here. That we'll all be greatly enriched and blessed by our time at Big Camp 2016. Father, forgive us for our sins and our weaknesses. Just cleanse us. Help us to support one another, to encourage one another on our journey home. Is my prayer, Father God, in Jesus' name. Amen.